It's a beautiful day for baseball in San Francisco. Hello again, everybody, along with Joe Simpson, Skip Carey, welcoming you to Braves baseball against the Giants. Greg Maddux will pitch. Terry Mulholland will pitch for San Francisco. On paper, this looks like a walkover for the Atlanta team. And let's face it, the Braves have the best pitcher in baseball going, Joe.
I think from the Giants' standpoint, Skip, you think last night you get a well-pitched ball game for eight innings. You think you're going to get your first win of the year against the Atlanta Braves. And then suddenly you come out today and you got to face the best pitcher in baseball in Greg Maddux. And that's not an easy chore, especially if you're the Giants. His last five starts against San Francisco have been brilliant. He's allowed only one run to them. This year, in his start in the opening day assignment, he gave up a home run to J.R. Phillips. He's been mighty tough on them, and he's been spectacular on the road. Last 13 starts, he is undefeated. So it's going to be a tough chore, no matter how you cut it, for the Giants.
So we've won the game on paper, but unfortunately, that doesn't count. Try to win it on the field when we come back right after this.
Atlanta Braves Baseball, brought to you by Bud Light. If you want great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down, make it a Bud Light. And by Aflac, covering the unexpected cost of getting well. Aflac, insuring over 38 million people worldwide.
As Skip said, a gorgeous day for baseball in the second game of this three-game series at Candlestick Park. Temperature at game time expected to be 68 degrees. Pretty good breeze blowing out toward right field as the umpires gather at home plate for an exchange of lineups. So let's check them out. Let's go to the Pep Boys starting lineup for Bobby Cox this afternoon. And it is shuffled a little bit as some guys are going to get some action today that have been riding the pine of late. Jose Oliva will be inserted into the lineup. He'll bat third behind Grissom and Blauser. And Oliva will give Chipper Jones a day off at third base. Fred McGriff is at first base batting cleanup. In right field, David Justice, who got the big hit last night to put the Braves on top again. Mike Kelly gets a start in left field, and when he has been a starter of late, he has produced quite well for the Braves. Charlie O'Brien will catch and bat seventh. Mark Lemke trying to snap out of a little skid he's in. He's 0 for his last 17. He'll be at second base batting eighth, and Greg Maddux is the pitcher batting ninth. Dusty Baker has also shuffled up his lineup a little bit this afternoon. He'll have Barry Bonds in left field, Deion Sanders in center. Mark Carrion will play right field today. Royce Clayton's the only holdover on the infield. He'll be at shortstop. Steve Scarsoni is at third base. Patterson is at second. J.R. Phillips at first. Jeff Reed will be the catcher this afternoon, giving Manwaring a day off. And on the mound, Terry Mulholland, 32 years old, 6'3", 212. Umpires for today's ball game behind the plate. Veteran Randy Marsh, the crew chief for this quartet. Wally Bell is at first base. Charlie Relaford will umpire at second, and Jeff Kellogg moves down to third. Terry Mulholland has had a rough year. Not only is his record something that he's not accustomed to at 2-9, an extremely high ERA of 7.25, but he's also been on the disabled list between June 6th and July 3rd with an elbow problem. In fact, he had elbow surgery in early June. They removed four bone chips from his left elbow, and he was throwing off the mound 2 weeks later. But look at the hits compared to innings pitched. That translates into a .363 average against him by the hitters in the National League, and he's allowed 14 home runs. He hasn't walked many guys. He hasn't struck out many guys. But everybody seems to be picking on Terry Mulholland a little bit. And the story around the league a little bit, Skip, is that maybe the age is catching up to him a little bit in terms of being a power pitcher. He's in the past been a guy who could blow some people away, and that's not true anymore. And it's going to require an adjustment from him if he's going to be able to stay in the major leagues, number one, to be able to hit some corners and maybe become more of a finesse pitcher than he has been in the past.
Yeah, and you admire a guy coming back that quickly after arm surgery. You know, you get paid whether you come back and throw or not. And he did, but maybe he came back too soon.
Could be. His last start against the Marlins on July 25th, he worked 5 2/3 innings, gave up 10 hits and 7 runs in that start, and lost 9-3. But his best start of the year came against the Atlanta Braves on July 9th. He got no decision, but he worked 6 strong innings, gave up 4 hits, did not allow a run. Walked 1, struck out 6, and he retired 14 of the last 16 he faced. He just couldn't pitch beyond the 6 innings, and the Braves were able to rally and win that contest. So Let's see how he works today as Grissom stands in. Here's Skip to take you into the play-by-play story.
Okay, Joe, thanks very much. Grissom hitting a 270 on the year with 8 homers, 26 runs driven in. 0-for-3 last night, but a big walk and stolen base in that 5-run ninth inning, in fact, to get it started. First pitch of the ball game. Nowhere near. 1 ball, no strikes. 68 degrees at game time. Just a gorgeous day in San Francisco. The 1-0. There's a drive, deep left field. Back goes Bonds and waves goodbye. Pretty good start. 1-0 Atlanta. 15 home runs given up by Mulholland in 72 innings. A lot of Braves fans here, as there always are. Here's Jeff Flounder.
The pitch looked like it was up. About a letter high. Let's see. Yep. His second leadoff homer of the year.
Number 9 overall. He has 27 RBI. That's the fifth time in his career that Grissom has led off a game with a homer. His second as a Brave. Blauser's had good luck against this fellow too. 9 out of 28 in his career, and a home run is included there. Jose Oliva waits on deck. Nothing wrong with Chipper Jones or Ryan Klesko. That's not the purpose of the exercise. It is to get everybody in the lineup.
First inning of the game that Mulholland pitched at Florida. In his last start, he gave up 3 triples in the first inning. And he has allowed 7 home runs in the first inning in his first 14, now 15 starts on the year.
Did he start against us opening day?
Yes, he did.
6 straight hits, right?
Yes.
But then, as Joe said, he pitched very well against us earlier this month. There's a strike on the inside corner, 3-1. In the 7th, Toronto hammering Oakland 16-5. They got 7 in the first. Blauser is aboard. Crowd is similar to last night, maybe a few more. You'll never see a better day for baseball than this. Oliva hitting 143, 4 homers, 10 RBI.
As a general rule, this is a great place to hit during the day. The ball really jumps out of here in day games. Might see a high-scoring game today.
Close over there, but Blauser gets back. Oliva just 2 out of 28 against left-handers this year. Breaking ball caught the inside corner, 0-1. That's what he sees a lot of, the curveball.
That's what Mulholland has always featured, fastball, curve, change. But he obviously has been pitching too much to the middle of the plate of late.
Line drive, base hit center field like a rocket shot. Blauser will stop at second. And Mulholland not fooling anybody yet. Here's Fred McGriff, who is 17 out of 33 against him with 3 home runs. And hit one here last night and just missed another one.
4-for-5 off of him this year. And that was another pitch upstairs. Mulholland tried to throw a breaking ball and it was a hanger.
So Fred stands in. Braves trying to score early, often. The outfield plays Fred straight away. Blauser a good size lead at second base. The pitch low and away. 1 ball, no strikes. Fouled off. It's 1-1. After the game and our travels last night, ran into this umpiring crew. Nice group of guys. I really enjoyed talking to Randy Marsh. I've been meaning to ask him for a couple years now if it was as big a thrill for him to call that Bream Cabrera play at the plate as it was for me to broadcast it. And he said, absolutely. It's was really shaken by it when it was all over. Just missed outside.
I thought it was interesting, too, how Of course, he didn't even start that game behind the plate. He had to relieve John McSherry in the second inning. But he said after the game, he got into the umpire's room, and his supervisor, Ed Vargo, gave him a big bear hug because he was in such good position to make the call.
3-1, and he also said that Ray Miller called from the Pirate clubhouse into the umpiring room just to say, hey, we got no... There were a couple of disputed pitches in that ninth inning. He said, hey, you did a heck of a job. Congratulations. No animosity. Jim Leland couldn't call because he was in a press conference, but class all the way.
Right.
And not so good for Mulholland. They are loaded with nobody out, and the Braves have a chance with Maddux on the mound to break this baby open early. Dick Pohl, the pitching coach, crosses the foul line and heads out to the mound to talk with his pitcher.
There's a story in the paper here about some criticism that of Dick Pohl regarding this pitching staff, the fact that they are last in the league in ERA. And one of the writers was quick to point out that it infuriates Dusty Baker and the rest of the coaching staff that Pohl would come under such criticism because he's doing the best he can with what he has to work with. That talk about, if you want to talk about Dick Pohl, talk about what he did to help the maturity factor of a Greg Maddux in Chicago when he was the pitching coach there. Dick Pohl is a good man, and he knows pitching, and I think under the circumstances, absolutely doing the best he can.
David Justice bats, infield back, willing to concede another run for a double play. Home run cut, but he comes up empty, missed a breaking ball, 0-1. Phillies and Cubs after five, tied 2-2. Mulholland wants Jeff Reed to start over with the indicator signs. Now we're ready. Inside, a ball and a strike. Mike Kelly waits on deck. Jose Bautista up and throwing already in the Giant bullpen. Low and outside. Two balls, one strike. He keeps digging the hole a little deeper.
He's just not able to work that fastball in on the hands of hitters like he used to. And as a result, they're not worried about the fastball.
Did he go? No. 3-1.
I thought maybe David was going to walk all the way down to the third base umpire to show him. He was headed in that direction and may have gotten a break.
Yeah, I think so. And Mulholland didn't need any bad breaks the way this inning has started. High fly ball, short center. Dion doesn't have much of an arm. Let's see if Blauser challenges him. He will. The throw is horrible, and the run scores. Sacrifice fly, RBI. Justice drives in his 46th run. It's 2-0.
And more importantly, Greg Maddux has a two-run lead to work with when he starts things today.
And it could be more. Still only one out in the inning.
Here's a case where, for Mike Kelly, Skip, he needs to be patient. He's getting a start, and it's hard to stay back and be calm about this. But RBI situation, he's been as good as any of the Braves hitting with guys in scoring position. Just wait for a good pitch to hit.
Right through there, 0-1. The stretch. 0-2. The strikeout has been the nemesis of Mike Kelly. He has batted 114 times and struck out 40 of them. The 0-2 pitch. Foul tipped into a strikeout. Two down. And Charlie O'Brien, the batter.
He got ahead of him with a fastball. Finished him with a fastball. Charlie O'Brien, if he gets that first fastball down the middle, he will not be patient. He'll be hacking away.
Two on, two out. If Mulholland gets out of this with only two runs scoring, he might feel pretty good about things. Because he had a run in, bases loaded, and nobody out. Into the dirt, Reed, a good play. One ball, no strikes. Oliva at second, McGriff at first. Mark Lemke waits on deck. O'Brien, 2 out of 15 in his career. He hasn't had much luck against this guy. Two and oh. Mulholland had a bad year with the Yankees last year. 6-7, an earned run average of 6.49. High fly ball, well hit center, but playable, I think. Sanders there on the track. He just missed hitting that one out, and the inning is over. Two runs, two hits, no errors, two left. Bottom of the first. Braves 2, Giants come to bat.
Braves get a couple to get things started here this afternoon. Let's check out Dusty Baker's lineup for game two of this series. Deion Sanders will lead it off. John Patterson hits second at second base. Barry Bonds will bat third. Mark Carrion stays in the cleanup spot, but J.R. Phillips is in the lineup today to bat fifth and play first base. Royce Clayton will hit sixth. Jeff Reed, the catcher, bats seventh. Steve Scarsoni is back in the lineup at third base to hit eighth, and Terry Mulholland is the pitcher batting ninth. For the Braves defensively in the outfield, Kelly, Grissom, and Justice left to right. Oliva's at third base, and it's Blauser, Lemke, and McGriff around to first. Charlie O'Brien behind the plate, and Maddux on the mound to make his 18th start. Five complete games and one shutout to his credit. Lifetime 11-9 against the Giants. He did win opening day in his only appearance in 95 against them.
Deion Sanders has had good luck against Maddux in his career, 5 out of 17. He's hitting 232 for the year, 0 for 4 last night. And a strike, that's not surprising. 0-1 is the count. 2-0 Atlanta, our score. Joe Simpson, Skip Carey with you. Joe fashionably attired in his new TBS sweater.
You've just kind of become a little fashion critic, haven't you?
Well, I admire you so.
I'm going to have to watch my stuff. Try to cut the sleeves out of it and wear it.
The pitch. Swung and lined down the right field line. That's trouble. That ball is up against the wall. Sanders heads for second. He turns it on when he has to. He's still not running well, but he's got a double. So Maddux is rudely greeted today. Runner at second, nobody out.
Must be frustrating for Deion, who's having to favor his ankle, to not think about a triple in this situation. But he, after he rounded first base, pulled up a little bit to glide into second. Justice came up throwing, and he had to turn it on again.
John Patterson, the switch-hitting utility infielder, stands in there. Close, but he's back. Patterson out of Key West, Florida.
That's a great place. Have you ever been down there?
No, I haven't.
That is wonderful.
Well, he must not think so, because he now resides in Phoenix. Deion, a big lead. The bunt is back to the mound. They go to first. 1-3, runner at third.
I think that's a good play. You're down by two runs. Could have been worse in the first inning, but anytime you think you can get a run to cut into the lead when Greg Maddux is out there, you do it. And rather than take the chance of making a mistake on the swing, they go with a sacrifice, and it works.
Braves go into the shift. Oliva didn't get the message, though. He's playing a normal third base, and now they direct him over. He's not playing anywhere near where Jones played last night. Fastball outside. That might have something to do with the way Maddux is going to pitch Bond.
Might, and of course, they want to make sure that Deion just doesn't steal home plate.
Bonds 24 out of 77 against Maddux, has six homers. So this is not going to be a walk in the park. Two balls, no strikes. Mark Carrion waits to hit next. Bonds 0 for 4 last night. That's news when you get him out four straight times. Deion halfway down the line. There's a strike right in on his hands. That's what he was trying to do to Sanders, but didn't get it quite as far in as he wanted.
What upsets the hitters, too, is the fact that they get strikes called on them thinking the ball stayed inside, but there's so much movement on that pitch that it cuts back over the inside corner.
3-1. Maddux will not give in to him here just to throw a strike.
He pitched a weird game here last year. Shut out the Giants, but gave up 6 hits and 6 walks. Left a lot of guys on base.
Ground ball, that'll get the run home. It's 2-1. Bonds drives in a run with an infield out. His 66th of the year, and Mark Carrion is the batter with 2 out, nobody on. Carrion hitting 305. A strike to the right-hand hitter. You see his numbers on the year. The Souls and Patricks from Mobile, Alabama here rooting for the Braves today. Knocked him off the plate a little bit. The Blaylocks from Gastonia, North Carolina. Kevin Rowland from La Follette, Tennessee. Among those rooting for Atlanta at Candlestick today. 1-2 pitch, here it is. Low and away, 2-2.
The way Carrion stands in the box, very close to home plate, Greg has to come in once in a while. That's why when he did come in, he made sure it was well off the plate, something he wasn't going to offer at. But he tries to keep him honest so he can go back outside.
2-2. Foul tip back. That got Randy Marsh. Still 2-2. O'Brien to the mound. This is one of those times when a catcher goes out for the umpire, really, just to give him a little time to get himself back together.
He has his hands on his knees, and that got him right on the bicep. Missed the chest protector and the shoulder pads.
2 balls, 2 strikes. Curve popped him up, but there's nothing easy in this ballpark. O'Brien has it, and the inning is over. Giants get a run on a hit. They don't leave anybody. We've played an inning. It's 2-1 Atlanta. Mark Lemke leads off the second inning in a 2-1 game. Terry Mulholland wriggled out of huge trouble in the first and doesn't get the second off to a swinging start. 1 ball, no strikes. Nobody on, nobody out. Second inning. Same two teams tomorrow. Then home for 3 with the fighting Phils. There's a strike. 1-1. Tomorrow it's Tom Glavine against young Jamie Brewington. Tuesday night in Atlanta, Steve Avery against Sid Fernandez. The wind, the pitch. High pop, short center. Patterson going out, Dion coming in, and the right fielder now calls everybody up. And Carrion makes a very shaky catch, 1 away. Wednesday night, Kent Merker against Bobby Munoz, and Thursday, John Smoltz against Tyler Green. Here's Greg Maddux.
Mark Lemke 0 for 18 now, and watch how he takes his hands with him on that swing. When you take a stride, you try your best to try to keep your hands back, but I think that's one of the reasons Mark has struggled lately since he came off the disabled list, is he can't keep his hands back.
Cubs have taken a 4-2 lead over the Phillies in the sixth inning, and they're still batting. 1 ball, no strikes. Foul to the screen, it's 1-1. Maddux hitting 146 for the year. Two balls and a strike. know, one of the problems I think the Baseball Network has.
Popped up right side. That might be playable. Everybody chasing it. The right fielder is there right on top of the mound. Carry on mixed catch. That's a tough play running uphill. Buddy made it nice. You never know when their games are on. I thought they were every Saturday night, but they're not this week. They are next week. Then they switch to Fridays a little later on. It's tough to
check your time and listings. It's a little difficult.
Marquise Grissom homered to start the game.
We're talking about Terry Mulholland's troubles this year and the fact that he had a rough year last year with the Yankees. This is a guy that started the All-Star game in 93 for the National League while he was still with the Phillies.
Inside, it's now 5-2. The Cubs lead the Phillies and they're still hitting. Well, they're still batting. We hope they're still hitting. Here's the strike, 1-1. On the right field scoreboard, it's 5-2. On the left field scoreboard, it's 4-2. I guess the news travels left to right here. High pop fly, short center. Out goes Patterson. On comes Dion. Patterson could not make the catch. And Grissom is at first base. We'll see how they score it. It's a hit. That's a perfect example of how deep Deion Sanders plays.
I was just going to say, you make a mark out there, make a little X in the grass out there, and then look and see where Grissom plays when the Braves line up next time. And that is a ball that he handles easily. And the reason is because, as you pointed out, Skip, he plays a lot shallower than Deion.
And he could have caught this ball, it looks like, but he veered away and let Patterson try to handle it.
They're not used to him. You know, lack of communication with a new player. You're not sure what their range is. Patterson hasn't been out there much.
It scored a hit. So let's see if the Braves can cash in after two are out here in the second. Mulholland has an excellent move to first base. There's a strike on the outside edge.
And that was a great angle to see how difficult it is to get a good jump on him, too, because we've been talking about Steve Avery's high leg kick. Watch Mulholland. He barely picks his foot up to start his momentum to the plate. Real quick step to the plate.
Ground ball to third should end the inning and does. Scarzoni handles it. Nothing doing in the second for Atlanta. One hit, no runs, no errors, one left. We go to the bottom half of the second inning. 2-1 Braves.
Hey, Skip, did you hear about it?
What's
this
that?
Telecast is authorized under broadcasting rights granted by the Atlanta National League Baseball Club and is intended solely for the entertainment of our audience. Any publication, rebroadcast, retransmission of the pictures or descriptions of this game without the express written consent of the Atlanta National League Baseball Club is prohibited.
Is that right?
Bet you didn't know that.
I didn't. Phillips hits the first pitch on the ground to short. Blauser throws him out, one away. J.R. Phillips is retired. And Royce Clayton will be the batter. Bertha Butterworth from Ant Hill, California, here at the ballpark, rooting for the Braves this afternoon. Clayton hitting 244.
Saw a lot of them in the ballpark today. The whole family came.
Yeah. Big colony of them here. Clayton stands in. Breaking ball for a strike. 70% of Maddux's first pitch offerings are in there for strikes.
Good story about the trade involving the Giants and the Reds and how Darren Lewis, Royce Clayton are very close and how Lewis was actually in tears over the thing. He grew up in this organization. He actually came over from Oakland, but Darren Lewis was a Giant at heart.
Fly ball foul to right for Clayton.
Must be one of those tough situations for a guy when you get traded like that from a team you love, but you're going to a ball club that's an excellent team and has such a great chance to be in postseason play.
Right off his thumbs. Lemke has it. He'll throw him out easily. Two down. Jeff Reed, the batter. 2-1 Atlanta is our score. They're in the seventh now at Wrigley with the Cubs on top of the Phillies 5-2. Reed hitting .273. No homers this year. He's driven in 7 runs. In the seventh inning, Toronto in a wild one leads Oakland 16-10. The pitch is down low. Three balls, no strikes. The 3-0 pitch. Right in there, 3-1 now. Funny, the Maddux will fall behind the left-hander.
Okay, it's going to be a stick one.
And he battles back to make it a full count. 3 balls, 2 strikes. Reed takes a little time getting himself together after that one.
He and Patterson don't get too many opportunities to start, but they've made the most of them, at least in the where their average is concerned. He's hitting .319 when he gets to start, and he's got a winning record when he's the starting catcher.
Payoff pitch, here it is. Hit hard, but right out the Lemmer, who sucks it up and throws him out. And the inning is over. 3 infield rollers at the end of 2. It's Braves 2, Giants 1. Third inning, third microphone, and Jose Oliva will lead it off for Atlanta. I think I finally got rid of that first microphone for good.
Yeah, I don't think you'll have any, I don't think you'll see that again today.
Oliva single to center his first time. It's a real pretty microphone. It just doesn't work. Mulholland into the wind. Check swing. Did he go? No. 1 ball, no strikes. 2-1, our score.
We were talking about Oliva down in Los Angeles, about how hard he has been working to stay ready to play. One thing he's always ready to do is swing the bat.
And that's what Bobby said today. He said, I've just got to get these guys some at-bats. Because if somebody gets hurt, or just keep them sharp for pinch hitting duty, if nothing else. One and two, the count. 2-3-0 for the Braves, 1-1-0 for the Giants.
As a player who goes through that, and you wait for your opportunities, it's a welcome sign too that from the manager that he's paying attention to you, the fact that you need some at bats.
He hit that one right off his shoe tops. Still a ball and 2 strikes.
It's nice to know that you're not forgotten sitting over there. Mike Kelly gets in a lot of ball games either for defense or pinch running. Not the case with Oliva.
Yeah, he does not possess good running speed. His bat is his calling card. He's robbed there by Scorsone. Nice play. The ball was hit hard. But Steve Scorsone timed his leap perfectly. One out. It's all right, Jose. Hit him like that. You'll be okay.
You bet. Tough luck. Bad luck if you've been sitting waiting to get some at-bats and to have a guy do that to you or to rob you of being 2-for-2. I saw Matt Williams in the Giants clubhouse before the ball game. He's got a cast just below, begins just below the knee. Talk to him about his comeback.
McGriff takes a strike, 0-1.
He says he's going to have to keep the cast on for about a week until the swelling goes away. That forces him to stay off of it, and they're going to re-examine him again in a week.
Breaking ball is outside. 1-1 the count. Two and one, Fred. He walked his first time. 2-1 Atlanta, our score. Grounded to short. That should be easy. Clayton, one of the best in the business out there. Two down. And after an awful start, Mulholland has settled down and pitched okay. Here's David Justice, who drove in the second Atlanta run with a sacrifice fly in the first.
This is what Mulholland did to the Braves in Atlanta in early July. Got into a real groove where he retired 14 of the last 16 he faced. He's on an 8 out of 9 stretch right now.
Low and inside, one ball, no strikes.
One of the Giants' acquisitions last week, Louis Aquino, a relief pitcher, was placed on the 15-day disabled list today with a strained right pec muscle. They called up Chris Hook from Phoenix to take his place.
A mile high in foul territory. Who wants it? It's going to be the catcher, Jeff Reed, hanging with it, making the play, and the inning is over. So the Braves go 1-2-3 again. We go to the bottom half of the third inning, 2-1 Atlanta.
Two to one Braves. We go to the bottom of the third inning. You were talking about the matchup on paper, Skip. Mulholland has lost 8 in a row. Maddux has won 8 in a row. 12 straight road wins over 13 starts. Quite a year.
And Steve Scarsone, who's having a good year in his own right, leads it off. 9 homers for this guy as a part-time player. He's hitting 270. And he hits one right back to the mound. You don't want to hit him back there. He's a great fielder, one away.
Have you noticed how often that happens?
Yeah.
When Maddux is out there, though, to start an inning and get one out on one pitch?
Well, they might as well, because they know he's not going to walk anybody.
I think that's an attitude a lot of teams take, is that they know that they're usually going to get a pretty good pitch on the first one, and they're going to go after it. But he gets a lot of first pitch outs to start an inning.
Phillies trying to come back, as you see. Scoreboard has it 5-3 Cubs, but I think we showed you a 5-4 score. The 5-4 is correct, and they're still batting in the seventh. It's up to my father to get them out. The 0-2 pitch, a little bit outside. Mulholland, 1-for-24 on the year, an 0-42 average. That hit a triple. He has driven in a run. That's out of play. Count stays the same. See ya. Two out. Maddux records his first strikeout. His 115th of the year to go with 11 walks. That is a pretty good walks to base on balls ratio.
I was looking at his numbers in that stretch where he's won his 8 straight decisions. That covers 12 starts. 6 walks over that period in 96 2/3 innings.
Incredible.
And you'd say, well, maybe he doesn't strike out many guys because he's got such good control, but 87 strikeouts in 96 innings.
Dion doubled to right his first time and scored the giant run on an infield out by Bonds. Wanted to bunt his way on, took a strike, nothing and one.
I saw Dusty Baker talking to Dion during batting practice yesterday, talking about if he's going to bunt, pointing toward third base as if to say that third baseline holds the bunts a little better than most ballparks. Thick grass here at Candlestick Park. This field's in good shape.
Yeah, it's Wrigley Field like here, too. They really let it grow. And cut down the ground balls, the speed of the ground balls. 1-2. 2-3-0 for the Braves. 1-1-0 for the Gents. Marquise Grissom has a leadoff home run in the game. Still 1-2 on the giant leadoff man. Fastball knocks him off the plate. It's 2-2.
See what Maddux does? I mean, it's you can't even call it a pattern, but Dion on the pitch before had good plate coverage, fouled off a very good pitch. And Maddux comes back. He's not trying to hit him, but it's a purpose pitch to regain the outside third of the plate and make Dion not as willing to go out and get the next one.
He was out in front, fouled it off, still 2-2.
But Maddux goes back to the outside corner, and as bad as that ankle appears to be bothering Dion Sanders, it makes it difficult for him to stay back on that foot and spin on it. He's got to come off of it, get out, get his weight out on his front foot a little more.
Into center, but look where Grissom had him played. Inning over. 1-2-3, nothing doing. 9 in a row set down now by Greg Maddux, and after 3, the Braves enjoy a 2-1 lead. We go to the fourth inning, but before we do, here's our Aflac trivia question. Who was the last National League team to win 3 consecutive pennants? I happen to know the answer to that. We go to the fourth, and here's a man with all the answers, Joe Simpson.
But you're kind of like Karnak in that way. Mike Kelly struck out his first time up and sends a drive to left field. Bonds goes back, still going, and he has it just shy of the wall. Oliva got robbed of a hit for extra bases leading off the third, and now Kelly gets robbed by Bonds. That ball was hit hard.
Bonds got a good jump on this one. Up in the strike zone again. He may have hit it too hard. If he got under it just a little bit more, he'd have had it right out of here.
Charlie O'Brien flied out to deep center to end the first inning when the Braves got their 2 runs. Fastball is low, 1-0. If you just joined us, Grissom led off the game with a homer. Then the Braves loaded the sacks on 2 walks and a hit. David Justice delivered a run with a sacrifice fly, but that was it. A mile high right out behind the mound. Clayton gives way to Patterson, who waits and takes it 2 away. Not an easy play to make. No clouds whatsoever. Very high sky here today at Candlestick Park. Mark Lemke will try to break out of an 0 for 18 skid he's in. Good fastball on the corner, 0-1. Mulholland's 2 starts this year against the Braves coming in. 8 innings, 12 hits, and 6 runs. But all those runs came in the first start of the year. That keeps Lemke honest, 1-2. Mark's only made 1 error in his last 126 games. That was in New York, wasn't it? Little bobble. 2 hopper. Tough play for Scarsoni, but he's got it, and a long throw gets him. Good play by the third baseman. The Braves go in order. That's 12 out of the last 13 set down by Mulholland, 2-1 Atlanta.
About to go to the bottom of the fourth. Before we do, we will answer our Aflac question. There's the question. The answer, the 42, 43, and 44 Cardinals who won 106, then 105, then 105 more. Billy Southworth, their manager.
Ooh. I wonder what advantage they might have had during the war years that would have propelled them into the 3 championships.
Well, they had that huge farm system.
A lot of teams. Patterson leads off and fouls it off.
They had a triple-A team at Rochester, a triple-A team at Columbus, a double-A team at Houston in those days.
Hmm.
I mean, they were loaded. Branch Rickey had built up that vast farm system.
Comebacker to Maddux on the second pitch of the inning. One out. He has retired 10 in a row. And the hitter will be Barry Bonds, who's having a terrific year, leader in several different categories in the National League. Not the least of which tied for the league lead in homers with 22. Leads the league in walks, which leads to a high on base percentage. And second in assists defensively, right behind Raul Mondesi. One and oh the count. Fly ball in a deep left center. Kelly's got room though. Just shy of the track for the out. He got under that one just a little bit. Two down. A brilliant day for baseball. Temperature right around 68 degrees at game time.
71 now.
71, man, that's perfect. Mark Carrion popped out to Charlie O'Brien his first time up.
We're just home for three games and right back out, huh?
Three with the Phillies.
Then on to Montreal.
Another fastball inside, but well off the plate to Carrion. One and one the count. You can watch Carrion from the center field shot and see that his first move is a little bit moving toward the third baseman. He wants something to pull. Maddux wants him to try and pull an outside pitch.
That's one of those times. Maddux cracks me up. He'll make a bad pitch, and he knows it before anybody else, and you can hear him say, "Racker frets."
Another comebacker. 12 in a row set down by Maddux, and we go to the fifth, 2-1 Atlanta. Greg Maddux will lead it off for the Braves. We go to the top of the fifth inning with Atlanta on top 2-1. All the scoring came in the first inning. Maddux hit a fly ball to Mark Carrion his first time up. Hot smash down the line. Fair ball off the glove of Scarsoni. That'll be a base hit. Maddux with a turn at first base just in case. A leadoff single. And Greg now 7 for 43 on the year. He hit that ball pretty sharp.
Yes, he did. It took a little funny hot bar. Scarsoni might have been able to make a play. Came up on him a little bit, got him off the heel of the glove.
Steve didn't expect him to pull the ball. And here's Grissom, who is 2 for 2 today, a homer and a bloop single to center. Takes it low.
Mike Kruko's little girl Tessa celebrates her 10th birthday today. We wish her many happy returns.
Mike, one of the broadcasters for the Giants.
Pretty good pitcher in his day.
Yes, sir. 1-0 pitch. Good swing. Marquise went after that fastball. It's even at 1-1.
Randy Marsh got tagged again.
Hopefully not in the same Oh, it is in the same place. Mercy.
Man.
Ooh. He might need one of those, like an elbow pad to.
He has now
slide up his sleeve.
Put his hands behind his back, but now he changes his mind. That's not going to work.
Breaking ball, but he didn't go around, or did he? Nope. 2-1 the count. Popped up again in shallow center field. Who wants this one? Carrion's calling for it, but Dion takes it. One out. Maddux still at first base for Blauser. It's such a nice day here that even though he's running the bases, Maddux doesn't want the jacket. He's very comfortable.
They're in the eighth now. The Cubbies lead the Phils 5-4. Phillies batting.
Blauser has walked, scored a run, and he's hit into a ground ball out to end an inning. Six for his last 18. In the month of July, the Braves are 19-6.
Toronto 18-10 over Oakland. They go to the ninth.
Oh. Change up and a beauty. Yeah, I saw a few balls flying out of the Sky Dome.
Yeah, they had
that game.
7-run first and a 5-run third, I think.
One and one to count to Blauser. That's a little high, 2-1. I don't think there were any tears shed from Tony La Russa over losing Ruben Sierra in that deal to the Yankees.
No, I didn't spoil the lead in the paper here. They really buried Sierra.
2-1 pitch. That's out of play. 2-2.
Something to the effect of Ruben Sierra, who never played hard here, will go to New York and hopefully mount a better effort.
He had one quote from Sierra, said, "Some days I'm happy, some days I'm not. You figure it out." Two and two the count. Off the thumbs, that might get down. On comes Bonds. He can't get it, and it goes by him. Maddux might score. He's headed to third, but Williams will hold him there. Second and third with one out. Berry tried to come in and make a shoestring catch, and the ball bounced under his glove. That'll probably be a hit and an error.
That's what it should be. He started to dive, then changed his mind, and then just came up too quickly.
He thought the ball was going to come up a little more than it did, too, and it is a hit and an error. Fourth error of the year on Bonds. And a chance for the Braves to add to their lead. It's 2-1. Oliva singled in the first and hit a rocket. Was robbed of perhaps a double by Scarsoni at third base his last time up. Infield plays in about halfway as the pitch is low for ball one. With the pitcher running at third, they're not in on the grass. I guess they feel like they will have time to throw out Maddux. But there's a drive down the line, but it's hooking, and it is foul. Boy, just a few inches for Oliva, and he'd be 3-for-3 with a homer.
That's the frustrating part about this guy, is and why Bobby's so desperately trying to get him some at-bats. Because he has such awesome power, and he has it to, he can hit the ball out in right, center, left.
He's not a guy that you look to hit 300, probably not even 280, but if he hits 265 to 275 and produces like he did in the minor leagues, that's what makes him so valuable.
And someday this fall or winter, John Schuerholz will sit down with Bobby Cox, and they're going to have to reach some kind of a decision as to what, are they going to give up on this guy? Are they going to package him in a deal? Or is he going to be a starter?
2-1 the count. And is he going to remain a third baseman? It's another option.
I don't know where else he could. Maybe first.
First. Off the end of the bat. A little blooper. In comes Bonds. He drops the ball. Maddux went halfway, stopped. Now he's coming to the plate, and he'll score. Maddux was not going to try to score on that shallow fly ball, but Bonds took his eye off of it too quick.
Yeah, and his anxiety to get it out of his glove and throw the runner out at the plate, he did the same thing he did on his other error. Just reacted too quickly. Maddux didn't know what to do. Watch him.
He was just going to bluff.
And he could hear Jimmy behind him screaming, "Go, go, go." So he was wondering the whole way. I wonder what happened.
3-1.
Blauser had to stay where he was at second base.
Back-to-back errors by Barry Bonds. And now some opportunities for the Braves to really bust it open with McGriff. Big swing. 0-1.
Apparently no RBI for Jose.
No, that is correct. Fred has walked. He's grounded out. Blauser got Mulholland's attention with a walking lead and forced him to step off. Right on the corner, 0-2. Fred with 13 RBIs in his last 17 games, but now he's got to guard the plate a little bit. 0-2. Change up, got him. Some good pitches by Mulholland. Definitely the best he's made this inning. And that good fastball on the outside corner that set this changeup up was the key.
Down and away, Fred missed it badly. And you got to give Mulholland some credit here. He's had deplorable defense, and he's not let it bother him. He just goes ahead and does his job. He should have been out of this inning a long time ago.
This is second strikeout of the ball game, and now Justice up there with two outs. David has a sacrifice fly, and he's popped out to the catcher. The RBI in the first inning is 46th of the year. Again, that fastball catches the corner, 0-1.
It's pretty obvious what you do in this spot. Hit it to Bonds.
Yeah. They're going to try. The crowd buzzes. Barry's got it. And he gets a cheer from the faithful, but the Braves get a run, an unearned run. On two hits, two errors, two left. We go to the bottom of the fifth, 3-1 Atlanta.
Bottom of the fifth inning, 3-1 the score. That gentleman right there came up one shy of tying the National League record for errors in an inning. But he put it away with a flare, the third out. Don Sutton, Pete Van Wieren with you for the rest of this one. Phillips, Clayton, and Reed to lead it off. A little bit of a shaky start for both pitchers, Pete, but both have settled down after the first inning.
Especially Maddux, who gave up that double to Deion Sanders to lead off the game. 12 in a row sat down since then.
Last time up with Phillips, he grounded to short. Takes ball one outside. Phillips, a product of the Angels organization, really hasn't quite panned out to be what the Giants were hoping. 1-1 to count. When Will Clark departed from here, they thought that Phillips might be able to fill part of those shoes, and to this point, it's been a little difficult for him. Maddux's changeup is inside, and it's 2-1. Did he go? Ask for help? Yes, he did. Jeff Kellogg making that call down there.
Another look. He went.
2-2. And he went again. I believe that's only the second strikeout of the day for Greg Maddux. One out here in the fifth inning, and Clayton will be the hitter.
Bottom fell out of that one.
Three straight days I have gone into the Braves clubhouse just to listen to a little pitching with Greg Maddux. Not talk pitching. I just go to listen. Gave me an interesting statement about his changeup, a strike to Clayton. I said, what is your best changeup? And he said, my best changeup is one that is not a strike. If I throw a strike with my changeup, I have hung it. His control has been exceptional this year. In the air, pretty deep to center field. Long run for Grissom. Sunglasses down, and he's got it. A lot of plays start out to center field looking very difficult. and ending up looking like a walk in the park.
A lot going on here. First, he had to find the ball, then get the glasses down, and then track it back to about 2 feet shy of the warning track to make the catch.
Two gone here in the fifth inning. Reed, the hitter. Ball one to the Giants catcher. There's a strike, one and one. Reed has been a number of places. He's been with Minnesota. It's fouled away. One ball, two strikes. Jeffrey Scott Reed out of Joliet, Illinois. He'll be 33 in the fall. Started out with the Twins organization into Minnesota, to Cincinnati, and then to the Giants. He's been involved in a number of multiplayer trades. Off the fist, little looper, fair foul. That's a fair ball. Kelly over quickly. Reed thinking a double, and he's going to get it. A two-out double by the Giants catcher puts him at second base. And it'll bring up the third baseman, Steve Scarsoni.
Not a bad pitch either by Maddux. Just did stay fair. Kind of a tricky corner here at Candlestick Park. You can see that if you charge the ball too rapidly, it could get by and scoot all the way down the line, but you got to be aware of that railing out there in front of the box seats.
Scarsoni thrown out last time on a comebacker to Maddux, fouls away the first one, and it's 0-1. I thought that's a pretty smart play by Kelly. You got two runs to play with, so rather than going over there and maybe over hustling,
yeah, he just waited to see where that ball was going to hit, whether it was going to hit there or go on down the line further.
Sometimes you over hustle that into a triple or an inside the Parker. No balls in one strike. Inside, make it 1-1. Scarsoni, a native Californian. He's out of the Anaheim area. Didn't mean to, but he finds himself at a hole, 1-2. He was a high draft pick by the Phillies a long time ago.
Having trouble making contact lately. His last 10 at-bats, he has struck out 8 times.
You can't look forward to facing a Greg Maddux when you're hauling those numbers around on your back. Maddux doesn't get the call, and it's 2-2.
Close.
See what Maddux follows that up with. O'Brien is not one who has a lot of meetings on the mound, but usually if Charlie is concerned that you may not be on the same page, he will not go through two or three sets of signs. Goes right out and has the conversation.
You think he was trying to sell Greg Maddux on a pitch there?
Yes, he was. I believe he was. But to his credit, when he works with a pitcher like Maddux, Charlie will try to sell a pitch, and if he doesn't get it, then he says, okay, what you got in mind? Let's go see if we can do it. Looks like they want it inside. It's there. Did he go? Didn't. That'll run it full, 3-2.
I don't know. We've seen that call before.
Runner at second. Reed had a double to put him there. 3-1 Braves. Payoff pitch coming to Steve Scarsoni. And he misses with it. First walk of the day issued by Greg Maddux. That gives him an even dozen for the year. What was the graphic we saw earlier? How many relievers have walked more than Maddux?
125 relief pitchers with more bases on balls this year than Greg Maddux.
Here's Mulholland, struck out swinging his first time up. He's one out of 25. First pitch swinging, foul. It's 0-1. The way Mulholland has been hitting after fouling that one away, he may ask for the ball for his trophy case. How'd you describe his hitting earlier? Some people don't hit their weight.
He's not hitting his number. He wears number 45.
0-1 to count. Make it 0-2.
You have to start wearing a lower number.
Reed at second, Scarsoni at first. Got him. 1-2-3. Two strikeouts in the inning. Giants come up empty. No runs. One hit. Two left. Five in the books. It's 3-1 Braves.
As we go to the sixth inning, a look at today's Budweiser game summary. It got off to a good start for Atlanta. The leadoff home run by Marquise Grissom. Greg Maddux trying to win his 13th consecutive road game. And two errors in the fifth inning by Barry Bonds, increasing the Braves' lead to 3-1.
And that extra run is always a big one. Kelly O'Brien and Lemke, first three due up here in the sixth inning. We were telling yesterday a story about some of the things that can happen to the wind here and about a pop fly that was hit that bounced off of the cap of Charlie Fox. And then you see the wind blowing today. I feel like was remiss in not telling you the tagline to that. The Giants had been struggling a little bit. When that happened, they were so loosened up, I think they scored six runs in that inning. First pitch swinging is Kelly. It's 0-1. Charlie had known he was could get that much offense and get his players loose. He would have done that a lot quicker. I haven't seen him in a long time. Skip was saying he bumped into him earlier today. 1-1 to count. We are seeing a lot of scouts with some of the changes in schedules that we are not used to seeing. 2-1 to count to Kelly. Bumped into Ron Brand, the former catcher for the Astros. Even made a stop with the Dodgers a number of other places. Two balls, two strikes.
Charlie Silvera is here, Bill Worrell.
Now, there was a catcher's caucus taking place upstairs here in the press box. The 2-2 pitch to Kelly. Did he get it? No, he didn't foul it. They tagged him out anyway. So Kelly is gone. Third strikeout for Mulholland. One out here in the sixth inning, and then Charlie O'Brien is the hitter. Pete, I know you know and you tell a lot of good baseball stories, but is there any place any better for getting those stories and when you get a collection of those scouts?
Oh, no, it's great. It's great just to talk about sitting back and listening to Greg Maddux talk about pitching.
First pitch to O'Brien inside 1-0.
Just surround yourself with three or four scouts and sit back and listen. And those stories range from scouting high school players to all the way up to scouting in the major leagues.
The next one, O'Brien upstairs, 2-0. I don't care how many computers you put into effect, and I know scouting has gone high tech. We do need that. That is the advances. Still can't beat some of those gut feelings by some of the old timers. A strike to O'Brien, and it's 2-1.
And scouts, for the most part, very insistent that their opinion is the correct one. I heard two scouts, I won't give you their names, but two scouts down in West Palm Beach in spring training one year arguing.
Little looper right field. Coming on is Carrion. He'll play it on a hop, and O'Brien has the base hit. Number six for the Braves.
And they were arguing whether a player was 5 feet 11 or 6 feet tall. One insisted the player was 6 feet. The other insisted he was no more than 5'11", and these two went at it for 15 minutes. Up at the lunch table.
I heard a similar one, too. They were arguing as to whether or not a guy threw a forkball or a split finger. But the stories are great, and if you ever happen to be in the neighborhood where there's a collection of those scouts, you got to just sit back and listen. First pitch swinging is Lemke, high fly ball. A little bit of a sun feel for Carrion, but the right fielder makes the play. Second out in the inning.
And most of the scouts that we run into played Major League Baseball when they were younger, and they've got some great stories from their playing days, too. You've got stories. To take a guy like Hugh Alexander, he can tell you stories all the way back to the 30s.
And most of them have worked for a number of organizations, so it's not just like those are all homer stories. Two outs for Maddux. Maddux a single. Eventually scored that third run. Fly to right his first time up.
Charlie O'Brien was surprised there. He wasn't even off the base.
J.R. Phillips might have been surprised on that one, too. Down low to Maddux, 1-0. I know that we're going... everything is getting more modernized, and I mentioned the computers before and young guys. Liner right at second. Whatever I was going to tell you will have to hold. It's an inning in which the Braves get one base hit and leave one stranded. As we move to the bottom of the sixth inning, it's still 3-1 Atlanta. Bottom of the sixth inning. 3-1 to score. Top of the batting order, Deion Sanders to lead it off. Sanders, one out of two, doubled and scored the only run of the game. Picked on a high fastball from Maddux, starting the ballgame, and doubled down the right field line for Sanders, his fourth double of the year. Patterson and Bonds to follow. Three runs, six hits, an errorless ball for the Braves. The Giants, one run. They've gotten a couple of hits off Greg Maddux, and Bonds has committed a couple of errors. Charlie O'Brien reminding Oliva to be alive for the bunt. That one's out of play, and it's 0-1. Maddux misses low. One ball, one strike. One more game against the Giants, that coming up tomorrow. Tom Glavine will be on the mound looking for win number 10. Sanders doesn't get the change up, and it's 1-2.
And again, that's going to wrap it up with the Giants for the year. Really seems strange after so many years in the same division with the Giants and Dodgers and Padres. We're going to be all through with the California teams tomorrow.
Playing 2 months without seeing them. The final 2 months of the season. There goes Sanders. Strikeout number four for Greg Maddux. And it'll bring up Patterson. Patterson, who made a pretty good impression on Braves and Braves fans a couple of years ago. It seems to me it was late in the year.
Off Mark Wohlers.
In Atlanta. Came in, pinch hit. 2-2 was the score in the ninth inning, and he whistled one out to right field. He is out of the Arizona area. A strike from Maddux, and it's 0-1. Laid down a sacrifice in the first inning. He got Sanders around to third, and he has tapped back to Maddux. So twice he has played pepper with Maddux, and twice he's come away empty. That got him. Looked like a cut fastball from Maddux. Got him right on the thigh. So Patterson will trot down to first.
This doesn't happen very often either. It's only the second hitter that Greg Maddux has plunked this year.
A glancing blow, so he should be all right. That'll bring up Barry Bonds, representing the potential tying run. And every time Barry Bonds walks to home plate, he is in scoring position. 22 homers, 65 RBIs. 24 out of 79 against Greg Maddux. A half a dozen homers, and he's drawn 12 base on balls. Picked up the only RBI of the day for the Giants at 302 for the year. The shift on by the Braves infield. Maddux goes outside with the first one, and it's 1-0. We have seen a pretty pronounced shift before, but I don't know that I've ever seen Jeff Blauser as far to the right of the bag as he is now.
And look where Oliva is on the left side of the infield.
Oliva playing like he is a shortstop expecting the hitter to pull.
You can see a 6-5-3 double play here if he hits a ground ball to Blauser.
That would be weird.
That would be.
How about a 3-5-3 double play? He has performed in clutch situations before. Count his way 2-0. With most pitchers, this would be a hitter's pitch. Not with Maddux. There's 3-0, and Maddux not happy. Down by two, do you green light Bonds 3-0 if he gets one he likes?
I think they will.
We will soon see. Takes a strike, but he did look like he was ready to swing if it had been where he wanted it. Knee high on the outside corner, and it's 3-1. There goes the runner. And the throw goes in the center field, but backed up by Blauser. I think that was ball four. O'Brien thought it was a strike, went ahead with the throw. It is going to be ball four. Second walk issued by Maddux.
And that is news. Two walks in a game.
And for Bonds, the 72nd time this year he's drawn a walk.
Maddux has only walked two hitters in a game twice this year. On May 2nd against Florida and on June 3rd against Houston.
So the Giants have the potential tying runs on. And good speed on the base pass. Patterson at second, Bonds at first. Here's carry on. He has popped to the catcher. He's grounded back to Maddux. Breaking ball hit into center field. Backpedaling is Grissom and makes the catch. And quickly gets it back to the infield. And Grissom is limping on that one. He may have landed on that heel that's bothering him. He is not 100%, folks. He is playing with a heel bothering him. But like he said, I have two choices. I can sit in the clubhouse and hurt, or I can play and hurt.
Good play, and not very good base running by John Patterson. If that ball gets over Grissom's head, he's going to be able to score easily from second. He went halfway to third. He would have been able to tag and move over to third after the catch by Grissom. See where he is? He should be back at the bag now, because if the ball goes over his head, he's going to be able to score anyway. As it turns out, he has to go all the way back to second. Too late to tag then. Another fine play by Marquise Grissom.
And he got the ball back into the infield in a hurry. Second out in the inning. Here's J.R. Phillips. 0 for 2, grounded to short, struck out swinging. Takes a strike from Madison, from Maddux. One of the real mysteries in baseball. His listed name in the media guide, J.R. Phillips. His teammates call him J.R. His name, Charles Jean. And 2 to Charles Jean.
Is he from Dallas?
Good question. No, he's from West Covina. He's from the left coast.
That doesn't work either.
No. He's in a hole 0-2 right now, too.
He has a son, James Ryan.
But they call him CG. Out of play. Still 0-2. Out of Bishop Amott High School. Isn't that where Pat Hayden is from? Down in Southern California. Now makes his home in Scottsdale, Arizona. He is originally out of the Angels organization. Off the fist. Probably a broken bat. He'll go put a new handle in that one, and it's still 0-2. By the time we see him next year, I promise you I will have an answer to that mystery. Giants got him from the Angels on a waiver claim back in December of 1992 when the Angels were trying to pare their roster down. They wanted to send him through waivers, get no claimers, and then put him on their AAA roster. Nothing doing, said the Giants. Another chance for Maddux. Tough play, good play. There is a term in baseball that is thrown around all too often, and it is, he can do it all. But that man right there you're looking at can do it all, maybe not hit for power. Giants come up empty, gonna leave a couple stranded. Maddux puts them away here in the sixth inning, six in the books. It's 3-1 Braves. Top of the seventh inning, Braves lead it. We'll go to Pete Van Wern for the play-by-play and another heck of a play by Maddux, Pete.
Outstanding play. We've seen him make plays like this several times this year. He's diving all over the place. Remember, early in the year, he got banged up a couple of times on plays like that.
Only the word welcome had been on the mat more than Maddux the first 2 months of the season.
Here's Marquise Grissom to lead off the seventh. He led up the ballgame with a home run. He's also singled and flied out. Royce Clayton on to first, one down. And that'll bring up Jeff Plowser, who has walked it into a forced play and had a base hit. Jeff has now hit safely in the last five games. His average beginning to climb a little bit now. One ball, no strikes.
Jeff playing here in front of a pretty good sized family following today.
His mom and dad both here.
His dad looks younger than Jeff does.
He is a young looking man. Here's the 1-0 pitch. Another base hit for Plowser. And he is 2 out of 3. That gives him 8 hits in his last 20 at bats, and that's the first spurt like that for Jeff Plowser in a long time this year.
Boy, what a good swing, too. He just went right to the ball, pulled the trigger on it. Jeff said he thought he may have been worrying a little bit too much about mechanics and technique instead of just being a little more aggressive and a little bit more for feel and reaction. But he's had some good cuts for the last 4 or 5 games.
That's the seventh hit off Mulholland. Now Jose Oliva was singled, lined to third, and reached on the Bonds error. Fly ball, deep left field. Bonds won't get to this one. Two-run homer for Jose Oliva. And the Braves now lead it 5-1. For Oliva, his fifth homer of the year, and his first home run since all the way back on May 16th.
He is a notorious first ball fastball hitter, especially if you get something on the middle of the plate inside about belt high. They want that outside, but look where it was. Dead perfect belt high, probably about the inner third, and he knew it, and so did Bonds.
So it's now a 5-1 Atlanta lead. First RBI for Oliva since June 5th. And here's Fred McGriff, who has walked, grounded to short, and struck out. Nothing and won the count.
Fred showing a little bit of signs of fatigue. He'll look forward to that day off Monday, a chance to prop his feet up for a day.
Here's the 0-1. High in the air to straightaway center. Deion Sanders broke back, but now comes in. He's under it and makes the catch for out number two. And that'll bring up Justice, who drove in a run with a sack fly in the first inning. 5 runs, 8 hits now for Atlanta. 1 run, only 2 hits for the San Francisco Giants. Final now from Wrigley Field, a 3-run homer by Sean Dunston in the bottom half of the ninth inning. The Cubs have beaten the Phillies 8-7. So if the Braves can hang on here, they will widen their lead over the Phils in the East to 8 full games. The count on Justice. Just missed outside. 1 ball, 1 strike. And that misses, 2-1. The count even on Justice, 2 balls, 2 strikes. David's been in a little bit of a slump of late, and he's not very happy with some of the pitches he's swinging at, like that last one out of the strike zone. Here's the 2-2. Blowing away, 3-2. He prides himself on swinging only at strikes. One of the reasons he walks so often. Here's the 3-2 on the way. Foul back. Still a full count.
I remember when he first started blossoming as a good National League hitter, he was closer to the plate than he is now. But even as a youngster close to the plate, he knew where the strike zone was. You see a lot of youngsters that can lose sight of it.
And that one just missed. Mulholland issues the walk. It's his third. A runner at first with two outs for Mike Kelly, who has struck out twice and fly to left.
Pete, I want to send along congratulations to some friends of mine, Jeff, Jenny, and Cole Copeland, on the birth of their daughter and baby sister, Taylor Copeland. Born Thursday at 7:45. Snap throw.
Good play by J.R. Phillips.
And a great play by J.R. Phillips.
Justice could have wound up at third on that one. One ball, no strikes to Mike Kelly.
Mulholland gets a lot of close plays over there on that snap throw, as does Steve Avery. When a runner is not really intent on stealing, he's just taking his lead. And you catch him about a step off the bag with that weight shift, it's hard to transfer your weight and get back.
Here's the 1-0 now to Kelly, taken for a strike. One ball, one strike. Mike's average has dipped below 200. It's down to 197. Two runs in the Jose Oliva home run. Here's the 1-1 to Kelly. Hit foul. Up into the crowd. It's 1-2 now on Mike. Justice at first with two outs. That's all for Kelly. Third time he has struck out today. And the fourth strike out of the game for Mulholland. But he gives up a two-run homer to Jose Oliva here in the top of the seventh to make it 5-1 Atlanta.
Coming up after our game today will be WCW Saturday Night. I know those of you who are wrestling fans know that that's normally at 6:05 Eastern. Tonight it will be delayed just a little. You're not going to miss any of it, I guarantee you. And a real special for you. Tell you after the pitch, which is a strike, and that is a real special interview with Hulk Hogan. So stick around right after our ball game, WCW Saturday Night in its entirety.
Royce Clayton 0 for 2. Bounces one out toward short. Two hops to Blauser. Across to first in time. One gone in the bottom of the seventh. Greg Maddux now working with a four-run lead. And you give Greg Maddux that kind of support, you can see what he does. That's incredible. 50-3. The batter is Jeff Reed. He has one of the two hits off Maddux. A bloop double back in the fifth inning. He's also grounded out to second. 0-1 the count. Tomorrow afternoon, Tom Glavine against Jamie Brewington in the final game of this series. Here's the 0-1. Just missed inside. One ball, one strike.
Weren't you saying Brewington was a Braves clubhouse visitor today?
Last night after the game, he came in to say hello to Brad Klontz. They were former college opponents, Brewington out of Virginia Commonwealth and Klontz at Virginia Tech. The 1-1. Little bloop out towards short. Blauser can't get to it. Over his head in the left field. Base hit for Reed.
Well, Reed has that stroke pretty much down pat against Maddux. Remember, he doubled down the left field side his last time. Up he has two of the Giants' hits. Right in on his hands. He just dropped the bat down on it. Look where that pitch is. That's below knee high. A little bit of an inside out swing. Got just enough to drop the top spin lob over the head of Jeff Blauser.
Only the third hit allowed by Maddux, and the batter will be Steve Scarsone. Glenn Allen Hill moves on deck. He will pinch hit for Mulholland. Down the right field line, up into the seats, foul, 0-1. Giants were hoping to have Matt Williams back by this weekend, but Williams played in a rehab game down at San Jose earlier in the week. Had a home run in the game, but that foot swelled up on him again afterwards, so they had to push him back a little bit. One ball, one strike.
Said it didn't bother him during the game, I understand, but afterwards it was sore and swollen. No need to take any chances if they're, maybe if they were a game or so out and it was further near the end of the year, but with a valuable commodity like him, you don't take chances.
2-1 the count now on Scarsoni. There's Matt.
He did something early in the ballgame that told me a lot about Matt Williams. When Sanders scored that first run of the ballgame, the guy at the top of the steps, the first one to greet him when he came off the field, and to greet Barry Bonds for getting the ground ball out to drive him in, was that man right there, Matt Williams.
Here's the 3-1 delivery, right back to Maddux again. This could be two to Blauser for one, the first double play. That's the fifth assist in the game for Greg Maddux. And it starts a 1-6-3 double play to get him out of the seventh inning, still leading 5-1.
Time for a look at our Delta scoreboard. Final in Chicago, 8-7 was the score. Cubs winning. That's one that if you were there, you had to love it. Phillies got three in the top of the ninth. Cubs answered with three in the bottom. Sean Dunston a homer to win it. The other final happened in Toronto. Took almost 4 hours to play this one. A couple of rookies going at each other. Ariel Prieto for Oakland. He took the loss. Giovanni Carrera made the start for Toronto, got the win. Gonzalez, Perez, and Gonzalez again. Home runs for Toronto, and all the rest of the activity in Major League Baseball coming up a little bit later on. That's our Delta scoreboard.
The new pitcher for the Giants, right-hander Chris Hook, just recalled from Phoenix when Luis Aquino was placed on the disabled list. He was sent down last week when Sergio Valdez was called up. Five wins, but an ERA of over five. And the count 2-0 on Charlie O'Brien. In fact, Sergio Valdez, who got that emergency start for the Giants and pitched so well last night, said that when he was called into Dusty Baker's office yesterday, he thought they were sending him down again. He didn't realize that Van Landingham wasn't going to be able to pitch. 3-0, the count on Charlie O'Brien. Eighth inning, 5-1 Atlanta. There's a strike, it's 3-1. Giants have used 23 pitchers this year with all their injuries. Hook 6'5", 230 out of San Diego. Out of Creighton University. Let's correct that, at a Northern Kentucky University.
Yeah, spent most of his childhood in Erlanger, Kentucky. That's where he grew up.
Charlie O'Brien draws a leadoff walk. Fourth walk issued by Giants pitching, and the batter will be Mark Lemke. 0 for 3 in the game and 0 for his last 20, overdue for a base hit. Hook, another one of those non-drafted free agents. You see a lot of them that make it to the major leagues. Strikes at Lemke.
Big guy with some good leverage. Falls off to the first base side. Gets a lot of movement on his fastball away from left-handers. Book on him is he has to pitch down in the strike zone to be effective.
And right now he's having trouble throwing strikes. 2-0 the count at Lemke. Nobody out. Charlie O'Brien, the runner at first. At that disabled list for the San Francisco Giants. Lemke hits one to first. Phillips, nice play, goes to Clayton, one hook covering, double play, 3-6-1.
Even if it's made against you, you have to admire that play. One thing J.R. Phillips can do is pick it at first. That is such a pretty play.
off quickly, steps inside to give the throw to Clayton, a perfect one, but the back end of that that makes it work, his hook was there in time to treat it like a first baseman. I think that is one of the prettiest defensive plays in baseball.
That'll bring up Greg Maddux. You know about Matt Williams being on the DL. Also on the DL for the Giants, all the rest are pitchers. Kevin Rogers, Pat Gomez, Mark Dewey, and they've also at various times this year lost William Van Landingham, Joe Roselli, Terry Mulholland, and Trevor Wilson. So they've had a lot of injuries to this pitching staff this year. Rogers has been out all year.
And even when they've been well, it has been a very, very forgettable month for this pitching staff. Way under 500, a touchdown a game. Look at the starters. And where they have really suffered, and we got a chance to see some of that last night, that bullpen ERA. When your horse isn't getting it done, the fallout effect is felt all the way down.
And it's taken the Giants all the way to the bottom of the league in earned run average, 5.02 as a staff coming into this game. 1-2, the count on Maddux. Top of the eighth, 5-1 Braves. 2-2. Hook missed with the hook. Here's the 2-2. That's all for Maddux, and that's all for Atlanta in the eighth. Nothing doing for the Braves. Still 5-1 Atlanta. Braves leading it by four as we go to the bottom half of the eighth inning. Tom Lampkin up to pinch hit for Chris Hook to start the eighth. Hitting .273, a homer and six RBIs. One of three catchers on the Giants roster, and he fouls off the first one, 0-1. Jose Bautista, who was up in the first inning, is up again here in the eighth, and he'll come on to pitch in the ninth for the Giants.
You broached the subject a little earlier. Let me ask you. Would you understand your role if you were warming up in the first and then again in the eighth?
I don't think so. I think I would know one thing. I'm not the closer out here.
You're not the starter, and you're not the closer.
I may be the finisher, but I'm not the closer. I close out those 5-1 games, and we have the one. In the air to center field. Grissom drifting back. He's got it, one down. And back to the top of the order, and Deion Sanders, who has doubled, fly to center, and struck out. Braves trying to beat the Giants for a 12th straight time, dating back to last year. They've won all six meetings this year. Already the banners are out here at Candlestick.
I have a feeling those are carryover from the days with the 49ers.
One out here in the eighth. In the air to center again. Marquise Grissom is there again. Two down.
I don't think anybody in the National League charts better and positions their infielders and outfielders better than do the Atlanta Braves. Jimmy Guadagno, who sits behind on plate, puts the charge together, gets him in the hands of Jimmy Williams. And you see so many balls hit right on the button that a product of pitches made in the right spot, and you look up thinking they're hits. There's Jimmy Guadagno. And all of a sudden, there's an outfielder waiting for it.
Two down. Here's John Patterson. 0-for-1, he was hit by a pitch, and this is going to be the seventh assist for Greg Maddux. A 1-2-3, bottom half of the eighth inning, still 5-1 Atlanta as we go to the ninth.
I know you folks sitting at home right now would normally be watching WCW Saturday night, especially a bunch of my relatives down in South Alabama. We will have WCW Saturday Night for you in its entirety, and it's going to be worth waiting for because a very special interview with Hulk Hogan. So don't go wandering off. We'll wrap up the Braves game, and then that'll come up right behind it.
New pitcher for the Giants, right-hander Jose Bautista. You see his numbers. He did have a very effective outing against Atlanta. Back on July 8th, he worked the longest relief stint by a Giants reliever in 6 years when he went the final six innings in a game that the Braves won 9-4. Marquise Grissom who led off the game with a home run. Braves have never trailed in this one. One ball, no strikes. Grissom, 2 for 4. He's also singled. Middle of the infield. Who wants it? Clayton. That is always a tough play in the daytime here at Candlestick Park. The wind, not really a factor today, but even without the wind, that sun, when you've got a clear sky like this.
And the reason Clayton took that play, Pete, Patterson would have come to straight to it looking into the sun. Clayton eventually was looking into the sun, but he got a look at it side saddle as he went over, so it was easier for him to track it.
Now Jeff Blauser, 2 for 3 with a walk, and he drives the first one to deep left field. Back goes Barry Bonds on the warning track. He's got it. And quickly two are down here in the top half of the ninth inning. That'll bring up Jose Oliva, who's made the most of a rare start at third today. He's gone 2 for 4, a single, and his fifth homer of the year. That really opened up the game for Greg Maddux. It was a 3-1 ball game at the time Oliva hit his two-run homer in the seventh. First home run since May for Oliva. One ball, no strikes.
Pete, talking about Clayton before they get off of defense, I think he is one of those guys, if the Giants are able to afford him, he continues to mature, that he will be mentioned here in this city in much the same vein and the same way that they mentioned Barry Larkin in Cincinnati. I think he has the tools, the equipment to be a real quarterback on a ball club.
Here's the 2-0 pitch to Oliva. Didn't get that one. 2-1. Yeah, the more you watch Clayton play, the more impressed you are with him, and he seems to get better every year. Terrific range, a great throwing arm, decent bat.
Good athlete all the way around, just like Barry Larkin.
Count goes to 3-1 on Oliva. Braves trying to increase their lead in the East to 8 full games over the Phillies, who come into Atlanta next week. This ought to be interesting. Scarsoni kept looking at Jeff Reed saying, you really want me to try this? You really want me to try this? But he was able to find it and make the catch, and it's a 1-2-3 inning for Jose Bautista. We go to the bottom of the ninth, 5-1 Braves. Bottom half of the ninth inning, Greg Maddux in command again today, leading at 5-1. Barry Bonds leads off here in the ninth. He is 0-2 today and 0-6 now in the series. Takes ball one from Maddux. Maddux looking for a sixth complete game of the year. That leads the league. In the gap to right center field, Barry Bonds is going to be aboard to lead off the inning. He heads for second, and he's in standing with a leadoff double. Only the fourth hit allowed by Maddux. He is also trying to do something here at Candlestick Park today that you never hear about other pitchers, trying to win his 13th consecutive road game. Mark Carey on the batter, 0-3. Crowd today of 31,772. There's a ground ball to short. Blauser looks the runner back on the first in time. One out in the ninth.
Well, Maddux, like, unlike so many pitchers, Pete, doesn't really get caught up in where he's pitching. He is more concerned with how he's pitching. And the way he figures it, when they go on the road, the only thing that happens, and he looks at that in such a positive way, is you get the score first. You're going to have to get 27 outs if you play a 9-inning game anyway. I wonder if this is going to pull the plug on it, or if Bobby's just going to come out and check with him. He is going by Randy Marsh first. That usually means it's something physical, not just coming out to see how his stuff is.
Well, he had Mark Wohlers up throwing before Greg Maddux went to the mound in the ninth inning, so Greg may have said something to Bobby in the top half of the inning.
He has earned the status. Every pitcher who sticks around for a while and has any success reaches a stage where the manager pretty much lets you tell him
unless you want to, you know, unless you're having one of those where you want to argue. But Maddux, I guarantee you, has a relationship with Bobby Cox that he says, hey, keep an eye on me. If I give up a hit, that'll do it. There's what we're talking about those road starts. That's unbelievable.
Randy Marsh indicating to Dusty Baker that that will not count as a visit. And J.R. Phillips, the hitter, he has grounded out to short, struck out, and bounced to the pitcher. We found out where the J.R. came from, too. When he was a youngster, his brother couldn't pronounce his name, Charles. He kept calling him J.R. That's where it came from.
Works for me. I know I will sleep better tonight now, knowing. After dinner and a couple of glasses of wine.
Bonds at second, one out. Braves leading it 5-1. Here's the 0-1. Little pop-up foul territory. Oliva almost ran over third base on Jeff Kellogg and makes a nice play for out number two. That ball wasn't hit that high, so Oliva really had to hurry to get to it. Two down.
They almost called an illegal pick on Jeff Kellogg, but he was able to get out of the way. That's a good job, too. See, he's looking right into the sun. Two things he's got to worry about. Three, really, with Kellogg there. One is to track the ball in the sun, and then two, to figure out how close he is to the stands. That's a tough play for a guy who's out there every day, but if you're not playing very much and in unfamiliar turf, that's a good play.
He has had a good game today. It's all up to Royce Clayton. Phillies lost their game on a three-run Sean Dunston homer. Toronto outslugged Oakland the only other afternoon action. Braves one out away from going 8 up in the East. Clayton 0 for 3. Ball one high. Here's the 1-0. In for a strike. One ball, one strike. Masterpiece here at Candlestick. Final score, Braves over the Giants 5-1.
Maddux masterpiece it was, and Greg Maddux, because of the fine performance today, winning his 11th ball game, is our AutoZone player of the game. There's some numbers on him. 13 consecutive road wins. That goes all the way back to June or July of last year. This year, his record, you see, at 11-1 with a 164. Maddux wins it. So do the Braves. 5-1 to score. We'll total it up after we come back.